I always never know how to start this shit. Greetings! That doesn't work.
No.
That won't work.
Greetings!
Hi!
Hey, yo, what's up?
What's up? Hey, here we are. We're back. Addicted to Loot. The Addicted to Loot podcast, episode number 4.
We're back and we're pissed. New
we're
and improved.
And we're pissed off.
Version 3.0.
Hell no, we won't go. We are 96 episodes away from our 100 episode milestone.
Woo!
That's amazing.
You guys never saw it coming.
I am Tom Jordan and Brian, you...
I am not Tom Jordan.
Who are you, Brian? Gee, I screwed that one up royally. Brian, what's your name?
I forget now.
Reginald. Mine. Hello, Reginald. Brian here.
Hey.
Actually, Brian here has been upgraded, had a patch over the weekend. Brian's been upgraded to version 2.7.
I am Bender, insert girder.
Brian, it's hard to believe that last week, when we were recording episode 3, you were an entire year younger.
I don't know. It is hard to believe. I feel like in this last 4 days, I have grown and improved to a point where I never thought my life would go.
Well, the long gray beard is a bit much, but besides that...
Hey, when you hit this age, you'll know exactly what happens.
I'm so tired and world weary.
Get off my lawn!
What? How do you feel... How do you feel... as time has progressed, your interest in gaming has evolved.
Well, I don't know. Going from the good old days of, Sega, Nintendo, original PlayStation, Xbox, so on and so forth, I think it has developed in a sense of a lot, not as big of a emphasis on action. It used to be all the big name games. Anything you're really looking at is like a combat simulator, first person shooter. Even the RPGs, for the most part, were pretty flashy. Nowadays, it seems like not everything needs to be that way. And you can, a good exploration game, survival game, even now, it's weird that we play games because they have classical looking interfaces, like 8-bit games and everything else. So it's kind of weird that we're kind of making a turn back from the old meta.
It's funny how powerful nostalgia is. In games that we've talked about, Starbound and things like that. These are games that are literally made to look like, hey, remember all those old side-scrolling 16-bit RPGs that you loved?
Yeah, and it's targeted for people about our age, but then younger guys are like, man, this thing's so cool looking. It's made to look so old. And we're like, shut up. This is what we used to have, and we thought it was great.
We didn't have none of this.
This was our high-end ultra graphics, you son of a...
I shelled out for this shit.
Basically.
I sold my firstborn. It's really funny because we've seen generations. We've literally seen, Minecraft, I feel like, is the first game where I actually felt like, oh, this is what the kids are playing these days.
Yeah, it actually was. I still remember I was in college when one of my friends told me about it and convinced me to get it. I'm like, okay, fine, I'll try it. But yeah, it was one of those games that instantly went huge in most, gaming circles or what you want to call it. But then I was like, oh, this is kind of neat. And then, it was one of those games where I came in well beyond the initial launch of, oh, this is, a new nifty thing. It was like, yeah, well, this is kind of cool. And, oh, look, people are making working computers out of it. That's pretty cool. Hey, look, I made a hut. Yay.
I made a 6x6 dirt house.
Hey, when I first started, the best thing you could do was pick axe into a mountain, put up a door, and just wait for daylight.
Man, I love that. I love building little mountain houses and stuff. And then you're like, you start digging and then you dig too deep and too greedily. And then you fall to your doom. And it's like, wow, look at all that lava. Hey, what's this thing that's coming up towards me? I'm going to call it the ground. I wonder if it'll be my friend. Hello, ground.
Speaking of Minecraft, I'm interested to see how this goes. But I saw something that some guy's daughter is spending hours a day to completely cover the top layer of a map. Corner to corner with dynamite.
Oh.
I can only imagine how hot or basically that the computer is going to melt when they try to render everything that's happening.
Oh my god.
But yeah, I'm intriguing to see where that goes.
Minecraft servers just go down across the world.
All because of what?
It's like, how did this affect the online servers? It was so powerful.
But
no, it's funny because actually what turned me on to Minecraft was Deadmau5, because I was at a Deadmau5 show and a lot of his visuals were Minecraft. I was like, okay, I've been hearing about this game. I'm going to try it. And I think it was still in some kind of pre-release-ish form. And because this was like late 2010.
Yeah, I hopped on like, I think, midway through beta.
Yeah. And it was one of those things where it was just like, oh, this is neat. I'm going to keep checking in on this as it goes. And I also allowed my mom access to it. And since then.
Yeah, she's kind of stomped both of us in that game.
I've been so vastly outdone. The things she makes, it's unbelievable. So cool. I kind of wanted to bring this up because I had a great conversation just before this with a mutual friend and former classmate of ours, Luke Merrill.
And ATL listener.
And ATL listener. Shout out, Luke. Right on, man. About games that we were weaned on.
Very nostalgic over the games that shaped our generation.
We were like... oh, what's the term? We were bred on. And that would be as fans of the Lord of the Rings films that were coming out.
Yeah, because when we were in high school, they were, what, either... They were out, what, but even before we got into real high school? Or, like, as we're going through, which is weird to think about. But, yeah, those, like, the original Fellowship of the Rings, Two Towers, Return of the King games that, once again, I remember Two Towers being like groundbreaking because you could co-op in it. Like,
oh, like it was so great.
You can have a legless and a Gimli, or legless Aragorn, or Frodo and what, Sam. But
it was so unprecedented even then to have a good movie tie-in game. Usually they were just, and historically they're just always shit. And it's like, this was specifically, especially the Two Towers and the Return of the King games were direct tie-ins to the films.
Yeah, like level by level was scenes in the movie.
Right, and but as games, they were fun. They were fun games. They went in some different directions based on film beats. Like, I remember the Two Towers one would do this thing, and just a heads up in hindsight, if you go and look at these cutscenes on YouTube, it's like, oh. But what it would do is it would show, like, the film, and then it would use some shot, like, of, like, Aragorn walking through the doors of the keep in Rohan there. And then it would segue into PS2-era cinematic-level graphics.
Which, back when, we thought was like, oh my god, look at this effect! And now it's like, oh, this is so terrible.
Oh, Aragorn looks like he's covered in, like, grease and...
Yeah, green goo, and it's...
Maybe made out of the same kind of material that potatoes are. but it's so... Wow. There was something about the combat system in that. It was like a combo system.
Yeah, it was a hack-and-slash game, but that was made with match combat in mind. Like, you had to level up your guy in a certain way that you... Depending on the enemies you know you're going to be facing, then if you timed a block or a parry at the perfect time, you did a cool finishing move, which then put you into, like, overdrive mode, whatever the heck that was called.
Yeah, you were kind of filling up, like, a special meter.
Yeah, and then but if you did, like, just one instant kill combo, like, the one, I think, like, if you parry at the same time and it does a cool finishing move, it instantly fills up your bar no matter what you're doing. Then you could basically just, like, perfect hit everything you kill. So then you don't have to worry about any type of parry or combos. And you just start slashing
so
through.
So great.
Or if you were a Legolas player like I was, you fill that up and then just use your arrows that have piercing on them to just, like, completely destroy an entire map's worth of people in, like, 3 seconds.
Well, I always, Legolas was my guy. That was actually what really got me into playing archers and ranged characters in general in future fantasy RPGs. Mm-hmm.
I it's just surprising because I was typically more of a dwarf fan when it came to Lord of the Rings. Like, that was, I'm surprised I went Legolas for some weird reason. But yeah, that was a character I played at least within the Two Towers. And then I guess toward Two Towers and Return of the King, because you actually had choices of all these different types of characters when I thought, I can't even really remember Fellowship, but I thought it was like, well, you just picked one character and that was it for your entire playthrough.
I never actually played the Fellowship game, but I believe it was made by a completely different publisher and company. And it was more tied in with the books specifically. Mm-hmm. Whereas, because the Two Towers game actually, I was reminded of this when I was talking with Luke earlier, that the first like third of that are levels based on Fellowship of the Ring moments.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because then it leads into the Two Towers. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. But those were, they were really good games. They were actually, they were pre Assassin's Creed as far as, before that kind of,
well, before, yeah, you couldn't even jump in these games,
right? And it was before that kind of combat started to cover everything, including Lord of the Rings itself with Shadow of Mordor last year.
Yeah, good point. 2 years ago. Yeah, and I liked Shadow of Mordor, but it the thing I didn't like about it most was that it didn't feel to me like traditional Lord of the Rings.
That's so funny you would say that, because Luke said the exact same thing. He said it was like, this was really fun to play, but without having that specific story. I mean, it was like a tie-in kind of prequel-ish story.
But the thing I liked about the traditional Lord of the Rings is that you were a warrior in a battle that, you know, you were with your training and your skills and everything else, that you were just kind of slightly above the curve and you were able to cut down these people, but after you made mistakes and you take hits, Shadow of Mordor is just like, I'm a god.
Yeah.
And I will slaughter everything I see. Like, I never got the sense of me and like 15 other dudes locked up in a keep going, okay, this is it. This is our last stand. We need to do this for all the women and children behind us. And like, you grind it out for like 30 minutes and then somehow you get saved, or you finally kill the last guy or something. But you don't ever get that feel of just utter overwhelming odds.
That's so funny. I never thought about that, but there is something really specific in Lord of the Rings about feeling like your back is against the wall at all times.
I mean, look at the final battle at the Black Gate. It was just, they're like, screw it.
Suicide.
They had no, like, we don't know if he's dead in a ditch somewhere. We don't know if he's gonna make it. This could be all for dumb reasons, but we gotta give him a chance anyway. So there's three of us versus 1,500 of them. Good odds. Let's just, for Frodo, and just let's start hacking some crap.
I mean, that's what's so funny about Lord of the Rings in general, is that they were literally like basically faced with such overwhelming bad odds that Tolkien had to be like, and then suddenly eagles.
Yeah,
and everyone's okay.
Every freaking time. That was always the one thing that bothered me about Lord of the Rings. I know it's like, it's a literary move and everything else, it's a choice, but yeah, it's always seemed like right when something was about to hit the fan, something magically bailed them out, and it was just like, why couldn't someone just like pull something out of their butt that was a little bit more believable versus, eagles, look at the eagles again, they're flying, they're here, but
it's funny because Game of Thrones recently in this past season ran into a problem kind of like that. It had a situation which was just, you already, it was well telegraphed how it was going to, how this shitty situation was going to be resolved, but it still felt a little cheap, and I think that's because Game of Thrones typically would not pull the and suddenly eagles card. There are so many moments in Game of Thrones where you're like, oh, please, eagles. please, eagles. And they never come, and the worst possible outcome does happen, and you're like, oh, that's why this series is so great.
Yeah, and I think in some ways you need that. I mean, look at the but Fellowship at the very end when Boromir passes. I mean,
yeah,
that to me.
Speaking of
like,
Sean Bean,
I was really sitting there going, I really wish he had a little bit more time to develop to be a character, because he was such this epic presence that just, you know, he did have an epic like, this is my last stand kind of moment, but still, it's just like, oh, wow.
I'll tell you,
no, I still have like heartbreak watching that final fight scene. I'm like, oh, he's going to save it. He's going to kill every orc in the forest. And oh, man.
That moment itself is the most Game of Thrones moment in Lord of the Rings, because that's just exactly it. It's like, oh, this guy, I thought he was a bad guy, but actually, he's a really good guy. And now I don't want him to die.
And then he gets
four hours super dead.
Super, super mega dead.
And, if you've never seen, dear listeners, the Expando Mixo full versions of the films,
yes.
The Two Towers does a killer job of fleshing out Boromir in a way that just will tug on your heartstrings.
Mm-hmm.
It's got some great scenes with him and Faramir that are just like, oh, this is salt on the wound. Now I love him. Lord of the Rings holds up. Mm-hmm. Those games still hold up as, like, if you ever feel like firing up a PS2. A
really dusty PS2. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're timeless. And even the Lord of the Rings Online, which, frankly, it is getting a lot better, but it's definitely not anything it should be in terms of those original games.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an MMO with Lord of the Rings, paint on it. But once again, it does not even come close to the real thrill of Lord of the Rings.
Honestly, I actually felt like Shadow of Mordor was the most that I had that feeling kind of returned again. In so much as the feeling of those PS2 games.
I mean, I would only say, I'd only agree to that because there literally is nothing else.
That's exactly it. Through lack of competition.
I mean, even if it's like 1% out of 100%, it's the only thing there is, so you can't compare it to anything. So I guess it is the closest we've gotten.
Well, just a heads up, EA, if you ever feel like re-releasing our...
Please give us another true Lord of the Rings game.
I guarantee that you'll have at least 6 or 7 sales with all of the old Pittsburgh School alumni. Just us
if
alone.
That's enough to make a million multi-million dollar game. Please just...
Basically, re-release that and a new Champions of Norrath game, and you will make...
Champions of Norrath 2, please. Actually, no, wasn't there a second one?
There was, Return to Arms, actually.
Yeah, Return to Arms, It wasn't as good as the first one, but still, it scratched a little bit of an itch, but I actually, is a conversation for a different time, but
yeah.
I really miss a good old hack and slash dungeon crawler, like
it's so
Champions
funny.
Of Norrath, what is it, Baldur's Gate?
It's really weird. Champions of Norrath exists in this space. That specific, I say Champions of Norrath like it's a genre, because it's like, again, Baldur's Gate, the console versions versus the PC versions. And we're PC nerds. We're a hardcore PC gamers. But there's something about those versions that was just much more, it was meatier games.
Yeah, it was a game that really... you didn't see again in the lifetime of PlayStation, whether even up through PlayStation 4. I mean, 4? Yeah, 4.
Is that what they're at now?
Yeah. I had to sit there and wonder, wait a minute,
back
is that right? That sounds
day.
Way too many. Yeah. But yeah, it's a game that I don't think will really ever be relived, and it kind of makes me sad.
Yeah, I mean, I have played and mostly bought and played 20 minutes of so many games. You know what's the game that feels the most like that is Kingdoms of Amalur. It's not as deep, but...
It's not nearly as deep. There's not ton... I mean, the hack and slash really isn't also there. It's kind of sort of dungeon crawler-like, but...
The thing about Kingdoms of Amalur is that you can go back anywhere at any time, but it is sort of pushing you along. Champions of Norrath... is pushing you down linear, specific.
It was a singular story.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even think there was a side quest to be had.
Right.
But the thing about King...
would have been nice if you could skip that.
Kingdoms of Norrath.
It would have been nice if you could skip that fucking anthill, though.
Oh, I hated that. Or the undersea level where it was more than possible, where you would have to kill yourself in order to unstuck... one of your characters.
And you moved like 3 inches per hour.
Oh my god. But yeah, it was a type of game that you'll never get. It was just like that overwhelming, swarming odds where there really wasn't such a thing. Like, you were literally just pounding an X button and maybe spamming spells and holding block consistently, but it was just... I don't know. There's just something about that, like, third-person kind of top-downy hack-and-slash, I don't know if chess game's the right way of saying it.
That's really
it,
a dungeon crawler.
Like,
that's like in its truest sense.
Yeah, I mean, it really was the very, like, the probably the last true, honest-to-goodness dungeon crawler. Yeah. I mean, after Baldur's Gate 2 and probably, like, Doom 2, I would say...
Doom or Diablo?
Sorry, yeah, Diablo. Okay. Wow, Doom 2. Yeah, Doom Tomb, the dungeon crawler. No,
I mean,
the,
Doom 2 does have a kind of feel to it, but...
but, yeah, it was... It's weird to think that we won't get another one. People could say, like, whoa, but there's Diablo 3. Diablo 3 is nowhere close to Baldur's Gate 2 or anything else. I mean, the story was kind of okay, but the way the skills worked, the way the enemies came in, the way the battles happened,
Actually...
I don't know, maybe it's for the better, but I don't know. I miss those games.
Have you ever played Path of Exile?
I think it's... No, it's been in my...
Is
it, buy list.
Is it Path of Exile? Yeah, Path of Exile. Yeah. It's free. It's free on Steam, and it feels and looks like those games in so much as those games that were kind of really grim for some reason. They always were, like, really a bit dark. Not by any, like, Dark Souls comparison. But it wasn't the bright and poppy fantasy that Diablo became, mm-hmm. or Dungeon Siege or things like that. It's a bit grungy, and the only thing I don't like about it is it is point and click combat, and I think a big selling point.
Oh yeah, I've looked at this game a few times.
Yeah.
And just always say no to it because of what you just said.
It has a mind-boggling skill tree. Just do a quick Google image search. I'm going to link it in the show notes. Just look up Path of Exile skill tree. Just I'll wait.
Are you looking for me to do this?
Yes. No.
Oh, fine.
This is
Path of Exile. Path of Exile.
This is worth
skill
it.
Skill tree. Oh my mother of God.
Yeah. So I mean that is
that's a thing.
That's cool.
How does this even
it's like I can't
how does this even
I can't
it looks like a circuit board. Like yeah. It reminds me of Final Fantasy X, but if you multiply that by 100 and put it like
yeah.
gave it some crack.
Yeah. It's immense. It's an uncountable amount of things that you can do. And
now I have to ask the question, do you only get one skill point per level?
And like one or two, and so you're just like, oh boy.
You have to be like, this looks like you have to be level like 2000 in order to even use all of
these. Well, it is one of those games that kind of encourages you to just go, you know. The thing that while it feels like Champions of Norrath, it definitely is an online game, so it's that kind of feeling of like no matter how many times you walk through this one area, there's always going to be guys spawning there and things like that.
Yeah.
It has that sort of, I don't want to say cheap feel, but it's like Champions of Norrath was a constructed narrative, as we said. It was a specific story. Once you killed a thing, it was dead, you know?
Well, I think the main difference here is Tempest Norrath, full-fledged game,
yep.
Path of Exile, free-to-play. I mean,
that
it's
being said,
always...
it's an amazing free-to-play game. It's absolutely, if you are vaguely interested in it, it's fully free, so download it and try it.
Coming back to current generation, getting away from the throwback kind of stuff, in the current now of Addicted to Loot, we would like to say...
The present now.
We would like to say a big how you do, hello, hola... Bonjour, ciao to all of our brand new listeners on either iTunes and or Stitcher. Bum, bum, bum.
Holy shit, Brian.
I know.
You are...
Over the last week...
a force to be reckoned
week and
with.
A half, we've completed, we've leveled up, we've gained the achievement, we've completed the
So this
accomplishment
is what happened when you got
of,
your patch over the weekend.
of ultimate hosting. So we're finally... We're up on iTunes and we're up on Stitcher... all of which can be used to download and listen to this podcast, but we're not going to be doing any more, so before anyone else is like, well, why aren't you on? No,
yeah,
just
no.
Shut up right now. I'm not doing anything else. This is
Please
it.
Know
There's
that
four of them.
Brian gave blood for these.
There's four of them. You're good. You can figure it out. I have faith in you. If you made it this far, you can probably figure it the rest of out on your way out.
Right. And in all truth, you know, if iTunes is your player of choice, you can subscribe to us on there and just get our episodes as they go online, which is really cool. You don't have to download them independently through SoundCloud. Same with Stitcher.
Same with Stitcher. And, yep, Stitcher works the same way. You can do it to just both of them, really. I mean, iTunes with the iTunes app, Stitcher with the Stitcher app. Yep. You don't have to really worry about it. You can do it on the go. You could do it really whenever. You don't have to, like, pre-plan for it. But take it with you on the
and
go,
we do
in
have...
the car, for a walk, wherever. In the bathroom, yeah. We don't judge.
We don't judge. We won't look, you know. We do have an RSS feed link in the sidebar of the podcast section of our website. So if you are a feed reader kind of person, you can subscribe using that, et cetera, et cetera. There have never been more ways to get your loot fix.
So, and we, like we said, we monitor all of these. So if whether or not you're leaving comments on any one of those four different things, YouTube, Stitcher, SoundCloud, iTunes, we will get back to you as quickly as we can, or whether it's Twitter, Gmail, anything. So
yeah, and on those the hosting sites, feel free to leave us a rating if it's 4 stars or up.
Only if not, you're banned forever, and we'll personally call you out on this podcast publicly.
3.5 stars rounds up to 5. Just so you know, it's common math. Everyone knows it. Moving on to news.
On to news, which is probably the reason why people really join us, as opposed to random throwing backs of Lord of the Rings. But
throwing
hey.
Back to PlayStation games. But.
Okay, well, the big thing in the news, probably in the PC world, really in the gaming esports world right now, is the Dota 2 International TI6 actually has started last week. So as the time of this is airing, meaning August 9th, or when we're recording it, sorry, not by airing, August 9th, Tuesday, this is... the second day of the main event, meaning this is the second day of the non-group stages. So for those who don't know, whether you're a fan of LoL, whether you're a fan of Dota, whether you're a fan of Han, these are all MOBAs. These are the, you know, you have 5 or so characters trying to take down towers, kill neutral creeps, ultimately to take out the enemy's base. And they have various...
It sounds so simple when you word it that way.
It does, but... all of them are completely at different skill levels. I mean, and it is very, very interesting, and we'll probably get a little bit into that later. But the Dota International is actually the biggest esports competition / event out there. This year alone, its total prize pool is $28 million.
That blows my mind.
$28 million. And the fun part is, only like $1 million of it is put up by Valve. The other 27 is all fan support.
I love how, you know, everyone throughout all of time, please make Half-Life 3, please make Half-Life 3, or make a Portal 3. And Valve is like, are you seeing this?
I mean,
are you seeing what we have here with Dota?
I mean, I remember I watched, and frankly, full disclosure, I watched TI 2, TI 3 fully, and then I took a big break until last Wednesday. But so I mean, I have a little bit of inconsistently here, but TI1, the very first one, its very first prize winner got $1 million. This year, very first prize is like well over $10 million. The teams that went out very first chance you could still got $100,000 in prize money. It is huge. I mean, what this is doing for esports is phenomenal. I mean, this is the point where their opening ceremony was almost a full day in of itself, and they actually had, like, what was it her name, Lindsay Sterling, the violin player?
Oh, of course.
Yeah,
yep.
She did the entire opening ceremony. So I mean, it is huge what they're doing. These are, you know, this event, tickets sell out within seconds. People travel from all over the world to Seattle, where it's been all 6 years. But man, and
I feel like this is a good time to do a shout out to an excellent film that is probably available from a whole number of resources, but I actually watched it on Steam, of all places, called Free to Play.
That is such an amazing video.
It gives me goosebumps. It's so good. It follows three renowned Dota players during the first international, I believe.
Yep, it was.
It's the first. And it's basically, by all rights, your typical sports film. You know, your kid from the rural Arkansas wants to become a world star NBA player kind of, you know, film. So it's, but it's, I mean, this is real. This is a documentary.
Yeah.
But it's really gripping because it's like, if you've never given esports a second thought, or even if you are into esports, it's, then this will be right up your alley. It paints the stresses and the tension and the excitement of competing in this thing where people are winning millions and millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars through championships throughout the year, but especially culminating in the international.
Yeah, I mean, it is absolutely a great video, and it does paint a very, like, I'd say esports athletes in a very good light, and I would definitely recommend it to anyone really interested in MOBAs, Dota 2, or even just, I mean, it's a good independent documentary, really. I mean,
right.
It got
yeah.
actually a ton of good reviews, even from independent press, so, I mean, definitely a good watch.
Yeah, but that's free to play. I'll definitely link it, and I believe it is, in fact, free to
it
play.
It actually is free to watch. So yeah. Please go ahead. It's a great video. And one of the guys, Dendy, was one of the main
I love Dendy.
He's one of the main contributors, one of the main highlights that they go over. He was on Navi, and he still is on Navi, all the way up through TI6. But he was on the original Navi team that took TI1. He was on the team that took the original championship and took second place in the next two. And then they kind of had a falling out, and they kind of dropped all the way up through today, I mean, or all the way up through TI6. I haven't been having a great go about it, but
what I really love and wish so desperately, because I love, in terms of esports, unfortunately, my favorite thing to do with esports is to put them on and fall asleep. Like, I'm the equivalent of the guy who falls asleep watching the Patriots game.
How,
you know,
could you?
And I know. Well, there's something really soothing about it. Like, the commentator, except
Luke,
when,
please comment on this video about how much he should not be doing that. Okay.
There's something really relaxing about the commentary on him. But I really like what esports are. I enjoy how seriously it's taken. Not to say that it should ever not be taken seriously, but they're given so much respect in terms of, I mean, God, things have aired on ESPN.
I was going to say, ESPN now has a full-time esports channel.
Yeah, I would love to have a second career as an esports commentator, honestly, because I just, I love the team made of,
Valve, if you're listening.
Hey! Hi, freelance! But carry on.
Yeah, so Dota 2 International 6, once again, it's about, I think, there's, what, 12 teams that go into this. Please don't quote me on any of this. I'm kind of pulling up a cheat sheet right now. But there's X amount of teams that go into this. It's a they're a mix of teams that are both invited as well as, you know, they come in through qualifiers. So
there are invited teams?
Yeah, it's if you win championship matches throughout the year, like it's, what is it, there's like the Frankfurt qualifier. There's a ton of them. I mean, so there's different ways to get invited, or even if it's just like overall performance in like the Star League or like the ongoing, I'd say like the Dota competitive league, I guess would probably be the best way of saying it.
Sure, yeah.
But yeah, so they have, what is it? There's six invited teams. This year they were OG, Team Liquid, Newbie, LGD Gaming, MVP Phoenix, and Na'Vi. The qualified teams are people that basically they take portions of the globe, like America, China, Europe, and they just have a tournament, and if you win, you get in. It's basically, that's mainly what it is. Same with...
And the qualifiers are intense.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they're just as big as main-level competition. So, like, even if you win, like, the Munich or the Frankfurt, like, major league tournaments, I think they call them major league tournaments.
Yeah.
But they're just as... I mean, they're basically the same level. It's just that there's... You might have a better chance of getting in because it's definitely location-based. But then even still, you have wild card teams, which, you know, are another teams that kind of qualify their way in. And then they have to play to even get into the team stage. So
that's a really interesting mechanic. Yeah. I didn't know that that existed.
Yeah, so there's six teams that get invited in. There's eight teams that qualify. And then there's four teams that get in as wild cards. I think they come in as wild cards from the other qualifiers. Like maybe they're second place or something. But
right, it's not like they're just completely pulling them out.
No, but the wild cards actually play each other. And then they get in, if they win, they get into the main competition. Which is surprising because one of the wild card teams, eHome, who had obviously had to fight their way to even get into the competition, are actually top, like went into the main portion of this outside team play, like number one. I mean, they were, they actually had the highest point total in the entire group stages. So it's interesting to see. That's one of the things I like about Dota. It's like any given team at any given time can be amazing. So,
right, and as you follow it over the years, these are not, you know, these are established teams, so you have these kind of narratives that you're following.
Navi has won a international, like Alliance has won an international, EG
E-Home's
has won
been around.
An international, Team Liquid, Newbie. I mean, there's tons of teams that have, well, I guess tons of teams. There's been five teams that won internationals.
Right.
No, the funny part is not one team has ever repeated international, and not one player has ever won two. So that's like interesting things to look at. But like Navi, Alliance, these are types of teams that have been there from TI1. And then a lot of these are like relatively new-ish. I'm trying to think. I don't know. I think there probably is at least one team, or if not two teams, in TI6 that are like, you know, this is their first appearance.
Yeah.
But then you have teams like Navi and like Escape. They were, or not Escape, Team Secret. They're made up of like old, like Navi players, but they actually went out the very first spot you could. Like they were in the loser's bracket. It's like you have one game. If you get, it's one game, do or die. And both Navi, Navi, Secret, Escape Gaming, and VG Reborn, all of which just went out instantly. These are huge teams. It wasn't like they were like,
funny.
You know, these are like teams that like, yeah, these guys are just going to get stomped and whatever. But no, these are like major league level teams. So TI, I mean, if you ever...
And these are over several games. This isn't like a one and done, like, you know, because everyone has a bad match.
Well, the first round of the loser's bracket is. Everything else after that is best of three. And then the final, so the for the money championship, I believe is best of five. So it's the first of three versus the first of two. But oh my god, if you've never, you know, never got into Dota, don't even know what it is, if you want to just go in and just watch replays of the international, if you go onto their website, just Google search Dota 2 International 2016, all the replays are free. They're up on Twitch. If you have the Twitch app, they're real easy to navigate through. I mean, it's just a fun thing to watch. I mean, if you just hear the commentators and how excited the crowd gets. I mean, that's the other thing I wanted to highlight. TI1, these are two people in booths on a stage that was like three quarters full. TI6, this is taking place in a stadium, in a circular stage in the center of a stadium. And there's like, there's 3D graphics, the entire stage is LEDs. I mean, it is absolutely amazing how much this has grown, even in like 5 or 6 years. So
yeah, I think that's really what can be said above all else as something that's mind-boggling. Not so much that like, wow, games as a competitive sport, but games as such a widely watched and consumed competitive sport from nothing, you know, out of nowhere. You know, baseball, basketball, football, soccer have existed for
forever.
Forever. Yeah. But for these to become something as an actual viable, you know, spectator sport, out of about 5-6 years time, a genre that didn't even exist like 6 years ago.
Yeah, I mean, the original ones, I mean, going back to even a Dota,
MOBAs are like one of the newest genres in gaming.
Yeah, at least from a competitive standpoint. I mean, Dota, the original one, dates back quite a long time. I mean, it was a Warcraft mod or Starcraft mod? I think it was a Warcraft mod. So,
yeah.
I mean, it does go back a long time, but it didn't get like into hardcore like competitiveness. Probably once it hit Dota 2 and like once, like I'd say League of Legends came out, it started getting competitive. Even Han,
I mean, I
remember it was a Newerth, actually had a competitive scene.
Right.
I think they might still do, but most people think of League of Legends and Dota when they think of a MOBA.
I mean, I remember, you know, StarCraft's competitive scene 10 years ago and being like, yeah, I hear that's really big in Korea or things like that. And just like, cool, that's happening. It wasn't anything that was earth shaking. And they were getting people turning out for these things, but it still seemed pretty niche, you know? And even, like, it's so funny because sometimes on Twitch I'll watch, like Call of Duty tournaments. And it just takes me back to, like, being at a friend's house and, you know, like, there's, like, six of you and you're switching off.
Yeah.
You know,
you ever lose, just pops out a controller.
Yeah, that's what it felt like and still feels like. There's just this something that's really niche and specific about it. But there, I don't know if it's because of the design of a MOBA or what, but there's a just something about that where an enormous amount of people can just know it on the surface and watch it and love it.
Oh yeah, I mean, Dota is another one. It's definitely, it's like League of Legends. It's free to play. It's like anyone can pick it up and play it. I mean, you could right now pub a match or play a public match for those who are noobs with one of these pros. I mean, you could all likelihood randomly roll a game with Dendi just because you got luck of the draw. I mean,
right.
That's one of the things that's really cool. I mean, like, they even said, like, one of the guys, I think, on EG, he says he starts out... No, not EG. OG. Starts out...
Other fouls.
Like, before he does any one of these, like, international matches, he does three pubs real quick, just, like, warm up and everything else. I mean, it's one of those things, like, everyone can play it, only a handful actually get good with it. But with the internet and with technology now, I mean, anyone has the likelihood to even be a very low-level competitive team. I mean, realistically, right. Me, you, and three other buddies could make a team together and just, through online hosting, compete in very low tier competitions. I mean, it's very interesting to think about.
I think what you're saying here is inherent in my, spoiler alert, my personal beef with MOBAs. Mm-hmm. I actually have an unpopular opinion. All of this being said, I don't like MOBAs. Mm-hmm. I don't actually like playing them. I don't ever like MOBAs at all. Like to play as a game. It's like I love that these exist and they're so immensely popular, and I love the rosters. I love the concept at its core. But I've never once... I have played Dota 2. I've played League of Legends. I've played Blizzard's one, Heroes of the Storm. Not to be confused with Hearth of the Swarm. Hearth of the Stone. All their other hot
stuff.
The other
Heroes
of Newerth. Yeah. I've played multiple different ones, thinking maybe this is the one that I'll get on with. The only one I haven't played is Smite, which does...
I haven't played Smite either.
That's sort of more like a third person.
It's like a tablet game, version. So it's like, I don't even know.
But the other ones, I have never once had a good time playing it. Like, I remember downloading Heroes of the Hots, Blizzard's MOBA, and doing like a tutorial level and then maybe one just regular pub match, and just literally saying to myself, I am not having fun.
Is it the core gaming concept? Is it the controls? Is it the level of complexity? Is it the fact that you got like curb stomped? Like,
I've never been able to quite pinpoint it, because gameplay wise the way you control a MOBA is like a real-time strategy. I mean, it's obvious it was bred from games like Warcraft and Starcraft. You know, it's the, all right, here's my character, click, attack that guy, click, go over there, click, attack the minions. And I like the concept as it's presented, you know, the strategies involved. I think it's too much of a team game for me.
Okay, so the fact that, like, so do you think if you had a full team of five people on TeamSpeak that it might change your mind, or is it just that it's too team-based for one person to get fully into it?
It might be that if I had four other people who were just devoted, or five other, you know, a team that were devoted to the game, and we played it every other day or once a week or something like that. Mm-hmm. And we had specific strategies. Like when you and I play Overwatch, we do have, we've developed certain like character synergies.
Kind of, yeah.
But even then, I feel like I can just, you know, fuck off as Lucio and just do whatever and still be contributing to the team, you know, because of his, yeah. I love, that's the weird thing is I love the team work of Overwatch, being a support character, being like, oh, that guy needs healing, I'm on it, champ, I'm coming for you, I'm gonna help you out, you know. But it also is still very self-run.
Yeah, MOBAs are very much unforgiving. And that's probably one of the biggest things that keep people away from it. If League of Legends is probably the least unforgiving out of all of them, because you can kind of scales differently, and your items don't really make a terrible amount of difference. I'll probably get a bunch of hate mail.
Even get me started on the items. Like, that's so above my head.
I'll probably get a bunch of... I'm anticipating a bunch of hate mail from League of Legends players. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying anything bad about it. But, like, a game like Dota...
It's just more accessible than Dota.
Yeah, I mean, a game like Dota, to your point, even if you're playing the support character, which really, you don't even... Yes, people hate you and call you a noob if you fodder, meaning you die a lot to the other team. But, ultimately, your job is to just kind of do minor little things here and there. You're really... Your team's match is not centered around you. But even as a support character, what you build, when you build it, and how you play it, and how you do team fights, and how you know when to engage and when not to engage, all built into one instant moment that can, you know, basically win or lose a game for you. I mean, it is... completely as like a daunting task. And then you look at all the heroes, you don't know how the heroes act with one another, then you have
there's
all the
a lot of
items.
Pressure.
I mean, there's a lot to take in.
There's a lot of pressure to not even screw up once.
Oh, it's terrible. I mean, I remember back when I was in college, my old roommate was really big into Dota, got me into it, and we would play a decent amount of matches together. And it was just, it was the same thing. Even if I'm playing a character that ultimately it didn't really matter if I had a great game or not, I still just felt like a horrible person. I just like beat myself up because I'm like, how did I die in that engagement? Or why did I give myself up there?
The first time I ever played anything was League. And I played with my friend Tim. And I believe we were with maybe one or two other people that we knew or that was a friend of his. And I just was like, you know, I am not a credit to this team. I am not a credit to this team, and I'm feeling like I'm not a credit to this team.
Probably the whole time, if I'm going to guess, it's probably very similar to my first time. You keep every few minutes, you go, okay, what should I build now? Okay, what should I buy now? Should I level this up first? Where am I going? Am I doing this? Should I go over here? What am I doing?
Right. And, you know, and even the most recent one I played was Blizzard's one. Blizzard's ambiguously named MOBA. And I just... you know, I spawned on the first public match, and someone goes, you know, all right, Tom, take mid lane. I'm like, what?
What's mid lane?
Huh? And it's like, oh, wait, no, you're playing as so-and-so. No, do such-and-such and jungle it. I'm like, what? Jungle?
Yeah,
you know?
It's a very hard thing to do for a new person.
Since then, I've come to know what these terms mean, but there's no matter how many tutorials these games give you, they will never prepare you for a regular game.
No, it literally is. You have to be willing to completely suck the very, probably, I don't know, first like 50,
months.
100 months matches. And just, you have to be okay with it. And you're going to have to be okay with people getting angry and everything else. And the sad part is, you won't be able to play or learn how to play a very important character in a very important role unless you try it. I mean, it's not like... you can play enough support, and then eventually you can play a carry, and then you're great. No, it's like you become a role. Like, if you look at any one of these big teams in international, they have their mid laner, they have their carry, they have their standard support, their off laners. I mean, there's people that are known for doing a specific role with some very specific characters. I mean, you have to play to get good in like one niche area, and then hopefully that builds into something.
I mean, that's something that could be said for Overwatch, because I feel like FPSs have transferable skill in so much as if you play single player FPSs, you can play a multiplayer FPS. You know what it feels like to run around a map and shoot a man in the head.
Yeah, the only thing you don't get is really how does another human being react versus AI react.
And there's something about a first-person shooter, for me anyway, that I can get into that headspace really quickly and really easily.
It's a comfort level.
Yeah, and I can get into the headspace of, okay, that's another guy over there. You know, maybe, especially games, really tactical FPSs like Battlefield, you know? It's like, okay, there's a guy that's sniping from that building over there. How can I psych him out in a way that will expose him so I know that my buddy who's over there with the, you know... artillery can just obliterate him. And there, I feel like there's something, maybe because it's grounded in reality, for lack of a better word. Mm-hmm. You know what it feels like, even with the nutty physics of something like an Overwatch or Quake or things like that. You at least can, I don't know, put some kind of definition to team of us men with guns versus team of them men with guns. Yeah. You know,
and there's still a portion of me, like, kind of like the flip side of what you were saying earlier. I mean, I do enjoy MOBAs, but I think I enjoy watching them sometimes more than I enjoy playing them, just because the people I'm watching can do things that I could never do playing.
Right.
But right. There is a sense of playing them that I don't. It's like an itch that, you know, can be fulfilled for me every once in a great while, and they're fun to play. There's something. You know, when you start like snowballing and racking up a ton of kills, I mean, there is just something special about it. But then you go to the very next game with the same character and just get utterly decimated. So
that might be part of it. I've never won a game. I've never been a part of any game where I felt victory.
I mean,
and so it's just literally, again, it's like I said, you know, I'm playing it and I say to myself, I am not having fun. I am actually not. It's not like, oh boy, this is really intense. It sucks that I'm losing, but I'm giving it my all. It's like, geez, this is a waste of my time.
Okay, I got to tell you guys this story. There's this one match that me and my buddy always relive, and I probably will always personally relive. It was a Dota match. I was playing a character called the Shrek. I don't even know if he's still in. I don't even see him in the PI.
I'm sorry, the Shrek?
Le Shrek. Oh. Le, as in le, happy le. You know.
Donkey.
Exactly. No, it's just this cool like little like support character that could potentially snowball into like more of a carry if you get certain farm and things like that. I completely forget who he was playing, but this was this match. We were playing, he must have been playing a carry because we were on the safe lane, which is the bottom lane because we were the good guys. None of this really matters. But anyway, and we were just getting owned as a team as a whole. Nothing was doing well. No one was really like saying everyone sucks. It was just that we were being outplayed. There's no two ways about it. We were just getting outplayed left and right. And we were just going, and we were just basically not dying. That was our claim to fame for like 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 40 minutes. And this game just wouldn't end. And it was like, we started playing over an hour. I mean, this one match was well over an hour. And like in like Dota speak, this is like, we focused late game unintentionally. But out of nowhere, we started picking off a few people, started playing a little differently, started getting a few items. And then all of a sudden, it wasn't even like we snowballed. We somehow squeaked a victory after like an hour and 20 minutes of grinding that like I was a pool of sweat, and like I forget, I was late to something. I mean, it was just this intense experience that like I probably would never get again. It's like, I'd say it's like the equivalent of like wrestling a bear and like winning, but it was just like
but losing an arm in the process.
Yeah, but it was like, that was the reason why I think some people really enjoy playing Dota. There's something, that adrenaline rush of this.
Well, I've had those experiences, but they're with first person shooters.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as far as competitive multiplayer,
like,
and
like, even
I
like
don't
playing,
know if it just comes down to personal preference or what. But
like even like some of the games that like we played together at Overwatch, like those games were like, we're getting stomped 99-0, but then we cap the point, and then we
just hold off for that length of time, like down to the second.
Or like you go into overtime and you're both 99-99, and then like you play for like another 15-20 minutes where no one actually takes the point. But I definitely can see it. But it's like, that to me is like something that I won't get ever again from something else that's probably not a MOBA. Like even when I played League, which is very briefly once I got into Dota, it was like, wow, League is just, and I'm thoroughly on the Dota side, so please let the hate mail roll in. But I will.
Well, talk a little bit about that. What really is it that sells Dota over League for you?
It's weird. The reason why I like Dota over League is the fact that it's so unapproachable, which might sound weird, but
I can get that.
But
yeah.
Dota 2 is so, I find there's a level of complexity to it that you would never get in League, at least from my personal belief. You know, disclaimer, but. That was
it certainly
thing.
Seems that way it, from an unbiased third party.
Yeah, I mean, it was just like the combat's very different. The way items work is very different. The way the map setup is different. The overall atmosphere of the game is very different. But overall, there's a level of complexity. And the fact that, like I said, if you lose like early game, if you just get stomped in a lane in Dota 2, you're almost definitely going to be basically a non-contributor the rest of the game. But in League, like I said before, they have ways where even if you have horrible gameplay, you could still somewhat be in the mix for the majority of the game because that's just how that scales. So that was the reason why, I mean, I will, to the day I die, be a Dota over League person. And it was just, like, I don't think I'd ever hop in the League again. I had one character I really, really liked in League, and I played the person a lot, and I got really well with them. But Dota is just, like, it's one of those games, kind of like Overwatch, when we go to set up. Like, I sit there and just go, who should I play? Well, this guy does this thing, and that guy does this other thing, but if I counter this guy by picking this character, well, this other guy's going to beat me then. Then you have to go, okay, normally I'd build this item on this guy about this time, but we're getting stomped in this manner, so I need to switch it up and build this thing. I mean, that level, mindset is what really just puts Dota over the top for me.
That's really funny you'd say that, because I haven't ever really acknowledged this to myself, but like with League, for example, I started right off with the character that most appealed to me. Gameplay-wise, it was the archer girl there, and mm-hmm. I was just like, there's probably a million archer girls, but you know,
the one with the ice arrow.
Yeah, whatever her name is. And I was like, okay, this is the type of character I would play in other games anyway, so I probably would get her quickly. And I tried playing as her, and I just, you know, wasn't doing well. And I did several matches. I probably did a good, like, 7 or 8 matches. So and they just never went well. I didn't have ever the knowledge of, gee, this is happening, I should switch to this character, or I should try out this character next match and see if I get on better with them. Whereas, like, with Overwatch, not only does Overwatch actually encourage that, it encourages character switching to react to situations, but I very quickly was able to feel each character and say, wow, Lucio, yep, you're for me. Wow, Reinhardt, not so much, you know, just in terms of my own very quickly trying a character out, even in the practice zone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And just being like, gee, I don't like the speed of this character, or I don't like the weapon set and skill set of this character. Oh, I really do like this one. Actually, when Overwatch came out and it had its like free beta, I thought that either Tracer or Mercy were going to be my characters, and it ended up becoming Pharah and Lucio.
It's funny how things work out in that manner.
Out of nowhere, I was like, wow, I never would have thought that Lucio would have been anything that I would. I don't typically play that kind of role. It's just like, he's my main.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you kind of bring up a good point. Like, even in Dota, like, when I've played, like, most of my Dota games, which is probably sad, are mostly bot matches. It would be, like, me going against, with a team of bots, going against other bots, and I'm just picking different types of characters I'm trying out or anything else. And typically, depending on the level, I almost always curb stomp the team just because they're bots. And
yeah, that's the problem with bot matches.
But it was just like, yes, it helped you understand the character and everything else, but you could only do that for so long. And you're like, okay, now I want to go into pub. I've done a few things. I can kind of understand how this works now. And then you start going to pub and you're like, I want to go back to the bot matches. I mean,
that was my experience with Blizzard's one there, as I did a couple
a
bot
tiny
ones.
Pick. Oh my god! Full disclosure, I'm screaming the international on my other screen. So if I burst out again, that's probably why.
But that's great though. That's great that you're able to have, you know, have that you're watching that right now while we're talking.
What did
about
you say?
Huh?
No, anyway. I'm just kidding around. But yeah, it is. It's just one of those things where it is fun to watch. But yeah, I mean, like I said, it's another one of those sports. It's like football. I would always love to watch it, but you're not going to see me go out and try for the team anytime soon.
But you know, you'll play football in personal matches.
Yeah, you go and like throw a football around with your friends, and it's just kind of fun here and there. But
actually, the thing that's really cool about things like Dota especially is there is really a football field, as it were. You know, a football field, a basketball court, a baseball diamond, those all look the same. No matter where you are, everyone knows what a football field's dimensions look and feel like. So Dota, you know, has its one map, right? Just one pitch map.
It's always the same way. It's evolved over the years in different patches and big updates, but yeah, it's still the same map.
I will say, I forgot about this. League does have its ARAM mode, all random, all mid. And I thought that that was going to be... I remember Tim messaging me and saying, here you go, here's your mode, here it is. It limits it to just mid lane, and I think everyone can only pick from a certain pool of characters. I don't know if you're assigned, I can't remember.
It depends on your play mode, but typically it's a all pick.
Yeah, and it's more of a brawl mode, kind of, again, like Overwatch. It's sort of a...
It's not... team. There's only one mode. It's you try to kill the other base.
Yeah, rather than the creeps and the minions and the towers and all that. And I thought that that was going to be it. I thought, okay, here's something that's a little bit a lot looser, actually. Doesn't have the competitive edge. And that was where, when playing that, I was like, no, I'm just not enjoying playing this game. Yeah. It's not that I'm having a problem because I keep losing. It's I'm having a problem because I'm not having fun.
Yeah, and like I said, it's definitely not for everybody. And I think, and like I said, I'm fully for MOBAs. I do kind of like playing them, and I pop in them every once in a while, but I'll never claim to be a MOBA player. But my biggest thing that I dislike about MOBAs, and it's kind of not even the MOBA's fault, but they're getting so big that other genres are starting to become more MOBA-like.
Yeah.
And I
do have a problem with that.
I hate that. I mean,
I have a problem with that.
There's games where, like, and when I say MOBA-like, I mean extremely arcadey, extremely fast-paced. I mean, it's probably the best way I could put it. And it's just like, I don't want that on most genres minus a MOBA. Like, that's really the only time I want to play that. Like, I remember watching a few videos now that I've even done updates on, on our YouTube channel, Addicted to Loot at YouTube, but
Addicted to Loot YouTube,
it's like I've had the realization where it's like, oh, this is a MOBA RTS, and that's horrible. I don't want that. Like, I actually remember watching an IGN video on like at this latest E3 saying, oh, we have a new game that we want to cover, and the developers say it's like a MOBA and an RTS combined. I'm like,
yeah,
no.
It's the buzzword of the day,
no,
for sure.
MOBA and RTS combined means shitty game that we're just trying to sell money off of because we put the MOBA tag word on it. And I despise it.
They're doing the whole sandwiching of like, what if Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon was a MOBA? It's like, why? You know,
why would
that.
Harvest Moon MOBA? I mean,
yeah,
it's like,
I can't wait for the Animal Crossing MOBA.
It's just like, I can't stand it. Please stay in your own field.
Stay in your lane. Yeah.
Oh my god. that is my major thing, and it happens all the time. I mean, any big game or any genre of a game that gets really well off. I mean, look at Assassin's Creed, look at Call of Duty. They all eventually start spawning clones, and then it floods the market and everyone hates it. And I still think MOBAs will always have League of Legends and Dota, and they probably won't go away. But please, just don't cloud all the other genres that I love. If I swear to God, if you make a Mass Effect MOBA, I'm going to track down the designer and personally end their life. And disclaimer that it's not a death threat, it's purely metaphorical.
It may be a death threat on my part.
But, I mean, seriously, like, do not touch certain things that do not need to be tampered with. Stay MOBAs, and that's the only thing they should ever be. Just like another genre that should never be touched by a MOBA is a game like Shadow of the Colossus. And you know what? We haven't had one of those games in a very long time until Pray for the Gods, which was, well, it's a special combination of games.
A weird collection of influences this game has.
Speaking of a weird random sandwiching of game types, this game is Shadow of the Colossus meets Deus Ex meets DayZ meets Bloodborne, out of all things.
Okay. Tell me more.
You and me both watched the trailer and the videos. I definitely get Shadow of the Colossus. I definitely get, you know, maybe some DayZ elements because of the survival, but I do not get the rest of it. But
Bloodborne, probably in terms of its
difficulty,
like gritty, grungy difficulty.
But even Shadow of the Colossus was super difficult. I mean, like, I don't know if you need another level of difficulty on top of Shadow of the Colossus.
What if Shadow of the Colossus, Bloodborne, DayZ, and Dark Souls difficulty were all blended together?
Oh my god.
Kill me now. Shadow of the Colossus, we should probably say, if you've never played that.
It is, I think we covered it in a little bit in episode one.
In all of our past episodes, we've
just
mentioned
about
it once.
it is like a genre-defining game. I actually watched an IGN video not too long ago about basically still, why do people love Shadow of the Colossus so much? Why do we always revisit this game? And I'll see if I can find it and link it down in the description, but it was a game that sought out to do something never done before, and it succeeded in such a way that I think it will always come up in, you know, what's your great game kind of discussions.
Yeah, it was the gameplay loop of Shadow of the Colossus. And I remember when this was first, you know, when we were talking
about
this.
On the PlayStation 2.
Yeah. We were talking about this in school, and it just felt so ahead of its time. And I will say, it's almost like a game from today.
Very much. I mean, without the graphics. I mean,
yeah.
It was... It had
now, was that a self-fulfilling prophecy? Was it like they made this and people were like, whoa, wait a minute. Yeah. This is a cool idea.
But it was not one word in narrative, but yet it told a full, deep story. Like, that was different. You did not know whether or not you were a good guy or bad guy.
Well,
like
it introduced the ambiguity over the course of it. Spoilers for like a 12-year-old game. Over the course of it, you gradually darken.
And you're just sitting there killing these creatures, seemingly just living their lives in this land. And so it's like, are you a bad person? Are the creatures bad things? They look like they're doing anything bad. Like,
right.
You start playing this weird narrative of, and then you show up just with a girl that's unconscious, and you think she's unconscious. Maybe she's dead. You don't even know. Like,
maybe you killed her. Who knows?
But
you know,
it was just like, that was brand new. That was groundbreaking. I mean, I would say the mechanic of the Colossi, whatever, themselves were even just a huge thing. I mean, well, haha. But they were, but in of themselves, I mean, the fact that it was a game where every single enemy or, you know, accomplishment you did was against basically a final game boss. I mean, every single
one of them.
Yeah, it
was a series of 12? 16?
Hold on, I have a screensaver built out of it. I can count it up real quick.
Oh my God,
but yeah, it's somewhere in there. I mean, it was double digit
boss battles. That's all it was. You basically, it was you and your horse, and you used the light of your sword, it makes more sense in practice, to find where the next Colossus was in a sequence, and you would travel across this stark and absolutely memorable landscape. Where it was just you and a bunch of lizards, you know, and the occasional bird. And you would arrive at the scene of a Colossus, which would in itself always be some amazing reveal. Just the first time you see the Colossus.
It was a mini cutscene that, like, kind of showed it off.
Always jaw-dropping. Always stunning. And they just... more or less got bigger and bigger. Some of them were small and fast, which were some of the more fun ones, actually.
Yeah, that actually was probably that my favorite one was like the third or fourth from the last. Was one of the really small ones that would just decimate anything it ran through. So
it was like the bull or the lion.
Yeah, like it ran through walls and towers and things like that. And it's basically like you had to get away. You had to like run away from it until you finally got it to a central location.
Yeah, and each one was a degree of puzzle solving. And, you know...
Where to stab it, where to climb, how to get onto it.
Yeah, the crux of it was that there was a point on each Colossus to stab to ultimately kill it, and a big thing you could do was climb, you know, the actual creatures themselves. Mm-hmm. And it was always thrilling. It was always creative. Actually, I think that my favorite one is that giant one that flies through the desert that had, like, huge, like, bladder things that you had to shoot.
Yeah,
it would, like, lower its wing, and you would, as it was flying, you would have to use your horse and just sprint,
yeah.
Catch up to the wing, and then go up in the air with it.
The air ones were some of the best ones, where, like, you literally are just... miles over the ground looking down, you're like, why am I hanging on this thing?
And you're always like, it had killer animation. I think that there was a degree, I always speculated that there was a degree of randomness in that game, because even in as far as you could whistle for your horse and he would come, it didn't feel like he always would respond to that. And I don't know if that was a bug or a feature, because it felt sometimes like, yoo-hoo, hello, horse, over here. Oh, yeah. Oh, okay, here you go.
Yeah, I'll come over now.
Yeah, and it was like that added, whether that was a bug or not, it added a degree of realism to this otherwise really surreal game.
But yeah, it was, I did count it up, it was like 16 or 17 boss battle monster things. But yeah,
16.5.
Yeah, it was. But that was the thing about them. Each one had a unique way to trigger the climbable points. I mean, the first one was just kind of a intro, like basically climb onto the fur and stab the shiny part. But then, like, there was one that it was a sand snake that you had to ride on your horse, turn around, and shoot behind you because
that was the hardest one.
Because its only weak spot was its eye.
Yeah, and it would pop up, and you would have to be paying attention to where your horse is going, paying attention to shooting a bow behind you, which is never easy on any kind of control system
at all. Yeah.
And it just was like you had to, you know, be on your toes at all times with that one.
Oh, yeah. And then it just culminates with this sequence of events that not only does it begins by like tearing your heart out and like smushing it in front of you to like this, the most epic of boss battles, to a conclusion which still leaves you with more questions than answers. I mean,
never had a solid resolution, and
I think that was the glory of the game.
People have continued to this day. I mean,
there's still people that play it nonstop.
Yeah, that probably came out, what, 2003, 2004?
Somewhere in there.
And there are still allegedly things in that that people are looking for, like secrets, not secrets like there's a hidden chest, but secret just...
Yeah, 2005 is when it came out.
2005. So it's 11 years old, and there are still things that people are mining the game for.
Well,
there's some fascinating videos and write-ups on
that. I was going to say, like, I think it was like not even like 2 months ago, I read an article that said like this guy spent like over... I forget, like 200 hours in the game, and he like found a whole section of the map that the developers said like no one was ever really supposed to find, and there's stuff like in there, like conceptual stuff and like other things that are just walking around that people weren't supposed to see, but the guy still put a video up of it, and like so there's still plenty of people that are still fully exploring that game to the literally to the ends of the earth. But yeah, it's just, oh my god.
And so you can, when, you know, put the way that we're describing it, you can understand why people would be like, I want another that.
They've been asking for it for forever, and if you think about it, the studio that did it, I mean, it was the only game, still to this day, their only game they've ever done, and it was arguably one of the best
games. Their only game they've ever done like that, because it is part of a franchise and ICO.
I mean, it is, franchise. But like, think about it. I mean, it's like, it's
but
really
it's not like ICO, and it's not like The Last Guardian, which is coming out.
Yeah, but like that's like their next big game from this same studio, but that's been in development for forever. But if you think about it, it's like this studio is really, it's not like they chugged out a lot of games or anything. It's like they had, what, two games with a third maybe on the way, all of which were these groundbreaking, well-received things, but then somehow the studio still just kind of slips away into the darkness and just like surprises you with one every once in a while. But but taking that into a game like we've been, people have been dying for a new Shadow of the Colossus, and people say like, well, The Last Guardian, it's like, no, it's not really the same. It's gonna be a different game. Yeah, it's a different game for a different episode. But I mean, looking at the videos for Prey of the Gods, it definitely has Shadow of the Colossus in it. I don't know how well they're gonna basically deliver on it, but there's basically big monsters that you have to basically do the same thing in some manner. You have to somehow climb them and somehow kill them. But mixed with some survival stuff of DayZ, probably with some minor combat of Bloodborne. Like, there's like minor encounters. Like, Shadow of the Colossus, you only fought the big Colossus, but in this one it looks like you even have like, I don't know, like minions and stuff like that you can fight from time to time, which might be like the Bloodborne aspect of it. The Deus Ex, I'm still not sure of. Maybe still three.
Maybe it must be the decision making of Deus Ex is the only thing I can think of.
It's set in this, what you would say, like a bit, it's almost like
kind of Nordic.
Yeah, I'd say like Nordic, Arctic land that is basically in the caveman era. Like, it's almost like the person you're playing, you know, makes fires, you know, makes little campfires.
It's very primal,
Yeah, it has to do, like, cave paintings and stuff like that. So it's very primal, but it's this mystic, frozen wasteland. But not even a wasteland, it's in the middle of a forest. So I'd say, like, yeah, you probably made it best, like, it's a Nordic forest.
Skyrim-y looking kind of thing, actually.
But if it was nothing but blizzard the entire time.
So, speaking of that, so I watched the Polygon has a gameplay kind of preview video. It's not straight, it's a little edited, but I was watching it and I started jotting down the notes that ran through my head as I was watching this video. So you can queue up the video and follow along, but basically they went something like this. Okay, this is a bulleted list of my thoughts during the Polygon Pray for the Gods gameplay video. Would you look at that snow? Wow, get a load of that snow. Hey, this is some lovely snow. What the hell was that thing, Jesus Christ? Oh my god, that's a grappling hook. I want to know who sold their soul to get these snow physics. Crafting equals augmented reality Minecraft. Jesus friggin' Christ, even the dusting of snow on the staircase has realistic snow physics. What the hell? Winter is coming. Oh hey, it's the whole third Colossus again. Haha, now she's on his butt. And finally, how soon can I pre-order this?
Yeah, I mean...
So that's basically 10 out of 10, 11 out of 10 for snow. This has the most incredible snow I've ever seen.
I mean, it is pretty insane. I mean...
It's got the depth of wading through snow, you know, and leaving the kind of trail behind you, the inevitable trail of... struggling to walk through snow. And as I was reading through the Kickstarter, that's I don't want to say exploitable, usable for if you get lost. You can follow your path. It's like leaving a trail of breadcrumbs.
Yeah, I mean, it's... I don't know. I'm trying to think of the best way of really, you know, putting some of the takeaways for this game. But... It did just hit. I forget exactly what their goal was on Kickstarter, but I think they ended up their Kickstarter about what, $500,000.
I don't know what the goal was, but they reached 500K.
Yeah. So I mean, it definitely shot up. I think after that video hit, it just really went up in popularity. And even still, even though the Kickstarter's over, you can go on to the main website. I think, which is PrayForTheGods.com, and still contribute. Still basically get, you know, beta access or just get like a preliminary copy of the game, so on and so forth. But yeah, it's a game I'm super excited for. I'm gonna be watching closely. But yeah, it is, the visuals of it are, I'd say, probably where it shines the most, at least in the current trailer, at least what we saw. It was almost kind of like a, I'd almost say like a tech demo.
Yeah, that's why almost. I was glad for this Polygon video, because it actually showed her playing and using the grappling hook to navigate, and the arrows and the crafting is this weird, again, it's like augmented reality Minecraft. It's got the Minecraft grid system, but it's very much in this 3D game, and stuff is sort of floating in front of you, and it's actually a little jarring looking, but I could see how it would work. My question is that this has the look, the feel, the atmosphere, and even seemingly the gameplay of Shadow of the Colossus, but how much of Shadow of the Colossus was that narrative? Because I feel like that was a pretty big part of why I loved it.
Like why you like the narrative of what the...
Shadow of the Colossus stood out for me because it told this, especially in its final minutes,
okay.
It had this narrative that suddenly became kind of clear. It still was ambiguous, but it became a little bit more cohesive, and it was like,
exactly
oh.
What you were doing, yeah. I don't know exactly what... the goal for this is going to be, like, I don't know if it's going to be another silent storyteller. I don't know if it's going to be, you know, I don't know what even what kind of role the hero plays in this, because it seems like because there's survival elements to it, that the silent hero or the unnamed hero probably has a bit more of a personal connection with it, just because you're going to be sneaking the caves to kind of make that survival point to make sure your character lives.
Kind of like the current Tomb Raider games is a vibe I got. Least of which because the girl looks like Lara Croft.
But, yeah, I mean, it's probably a good connection between the two. But, yeah, I'm not sure what their goal is for the lore for the actual story that they're going to be walking you through. Because right now it seemed like when I was going through their FAQ on their website, it seemed like they were planning for something like 8 total big monsters, with depending on how much crowdfunding they got. So I don't know if that eight monsters was pre-500,000K or post.
Right.
But it's going to be interesting to see. It's a game that, if any of this sounds appealing to you, I would highly recommend just do a quick Google search. Tons of information is going to pop up.
Yeah, and as always, we'll be linking a heck ton of stuff in our website show notes. So
yeah, I mean, it's definitely a game worthwhile. I mean, that's something that you should definitely check out. And if always, you can always plop down a few bucks and maybe, you know, get beta access and stuff like that.
Yeah, and oh my god, if you haven't ever played Shadow of the Colossus,
oh, if you have a PS4, there's a remastered Shadow of the Colossus in the PlayStation Store. It actually was a free game if you had PlayStation Plus not too long ago. I don't think it's in there anymore. But it was one of the best free grabs I've ever got, just because I love that game and I wanted to replay it. But
how was the remaster?
I did the first Colossus, and for some odd reason, I don't know if it's because I really don't know, I couldn't pinpoint it. It didn't feel right to me, and I don't know if it's because I was holding a PlayStation 4 trailer instead of 2, if it was because the game was so remastered that things flowed too smoothly to feel like Shadow of the Colossus.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It
seemed like, almost seemed like things happened quicker because things were smoother, and I didn't really like it. I felt like my controls weren't as heavy as the original one was.
Yeah,
but
really funny. You're exactly right. There's something about the way that Shadow of the Colossus controlled, at least on the PS2, that felt very clunky in a good way. It felt very weighty.
If one of these things tried to take a step and shake you off, you felt I need to push the button harder. Maybe I hold on harder.
Yeah, I probably broke, buttons on PS2 controllers playing that game for that exact reason of maybe if I push harder, he'll hold on harder.
Yeah, but for the remake, it just felt like, yeah, I'm holding this button. It has no impact. Yep, he's either going to hold on or not hold on. Look at the meter go down. Okay, that's the only thing I need to worry about. But yeah, it didn't have the feel.
So you don't think it wasn't like a nostalgia thing slapping you in the face?
I don't know. Maybe it was just because I have an idea of what I was hoping the remake was going to be in my head. Like, I was hoping to have the same exact feeling as the original one, and I didn't. I don't know if that put a damper on it or what, but it's definitely, don't get me wrong, if you never played it before, please go play the remastered one. It is absolutely amazing. I mean, the game, you can't, and like I said, they didn't mess with the game at all. They just basically cleaned it up and re-released it. It's definitely worth your while.
Awesome. Speaking of re-releases. Amiga has now joined MS-DOS and Windows 3.1 in providing a shit ton of games playable for free in your browser.
2,000 plus games.
I mean, this is incredible. This, to someone who has any kind of tie to games of the, I would imagine, late 80s and early 90s in my case, and maybe grew up with some of these, especially MS-DOS and Windows 3.1 ones, it was like, oh my god, to be able to, first off, to play these games, which probably I have like the floppy disks of somewhere in my attic, you know, like those are never getting used again. But they're all for free. They're all online. It's overwhelming. It's absolutely overwhelming. It's just using a DOSBox emulator system through your browser, which is great because DOSBox can be a pain in the ass on your computer. Old classic, you know, 8-bit games that we all grew up with. I mean, it could be as simple as having your favorite version of Pac-Man for the Amiga or tie-in games or things like that. Go play them. Go play them. They're there. They're all there. There hasn't been one yet that I haven't been able to find.
Yeah, I mean, they're all tons of games, even going back to like stuff like, you know, traditional, like the Aladdin game, the Lion King game.
Yes.
The traditional 2D, I would say, kind of the start of platformers. Like, there's tons of stuff in there. I mean,
Aladdin, Lion King, and Jungle Book have actually just been re-released, I guess, or released for PC on GOG, which is cool, but I do have a caveat here. If you have an emulator, just you know, go play on that. But yes, if you want to shell out a few bucks for these, go ahead. Lion King was the first like first game that showed me that platforming can just be a real asshole sometimes. I loved it. I loved the Lion King game, but there are some levels in that. Anyone who's played that, all I need to say is the monkeys, you know?
I was waiting for you to put, I was like, I wonder if he's going to say it. I wonder if he's going
to
say it.
All I need to say is those goddamn pink and blue monkeys. And, I still have the scars from that. But that being said, going back to our earlier talk about Lord of the Rings, it's a fun tie-in game. I remember the later game stuff where your adult Simba kind of was kind of fun. Yeah. But yeah, so if you're a fan of retro games, worth mentioning, Amiga has joined the ranks. I think it's all through archive.org, you know, the same site that does the Wayback Machine and all that. Go for it. Ski free. Ever wanted to play Ski Free again? Go play Ski Free.
Go forth and prosper.
Go forth and prosper. I had a shareware disc. I had a lot of shareware discs. My mom had a habit of buying me shareware discs. And there was one that had, like, Doom on it. It had, like, I think it was, like, Street Fighter or something like that. Jill of the Jungle. Holy shit, Jill of the Jungle. I could do an entire podcast about Jill of the Jungle. I don't even get me started. I can't even open that door right now. But there are some classics out there that are worth checking out. For sure.
No, definitely. Go out and try it.
Moving on to our playlist.
All the things that we did this past week.
Oh, boy. I feel bad because I didn't do that much. But, Brian, you did something that we talked about last week.
This was one of those things where you might have heard in last week's episode that I was actively signing up for the Elder Scrolls Legends beta as Tommy was talking about it, and well, like the next day, not even like less than 12 hours, I was like, yeah, you got accepted into the beta. So I've also been playing a bunch of Elder Scrolls Legends, and I could safely say everything that you said about it I 100% agree with.
Yay!
it is an incredible card game, to the point where
it's so good.
It definitely is a mix between what Hearthstone, as well as I would say Magic, in the sense of not nearly as long as Magic, but more complex than Hearthstone.
Right. That's like, exactly
it's a good mix. I do like the fact that their quote unquote story missions have special features to them, like you said, like the bottle throwing, or like randomly assigning like weapons and armor to people as you play them. So there's a little bit of like random number generating goodness in there, but that's something like in like Magic, when you play like Duels with a Planeswalker 1 or 2 and you do the story missions, every once in a while they'll have like a special like I'd say encounter mission where there's a very specific thing that happens, like you need to kill all 10 of these pre-spawned opponents before you finish the game or something like that. But in Legends or Elder Scrolls Legends, like every one of the story missions, it's something special, whether it's like they start out with more people, there's different effects on the map.
There's
like
a wolf pack, and each time,
yeah,
each turn,
pack,
a wolf
spider,
comes out.
Hordes, I mean, whether or not people, like, one card randomly gets one damage every turn. I mean, it keeps the game fresh. It keeps it, like, I even had, there's times where, like, the very first time I would play a story mission, it was hard. I mean, it was, whether or not I was trying to test out a new deck for the first time.
Yeah, what, what deck did you end up settling on? Or are you making custom?
So far, my most... The deck I'm probably relating with most, or probably having the best synergy with, is the Orc deck, which is,
really?
What, red and yellow?
Yeah.
I believe.
Strength and willpower, I think.
Yeah, strength and willpower. I mean, I'm liking it a lot. There's other decks I'm trying out as well that just to, you know, I try out every deck at least for like 3 battles just to see like, do I like it or don't I like it?
I need to do that because I just immediately got on with the first deck of the Smugglers.
The Smugglers deck I actually really liked as well.
Yeah.
There's just, and then there's a thing about maybe this should be my main, like, but then I brought myself back to my original Orc deck mainly because the person you pick, like your starting character affects how you get certain cards. And
yeah, we never mentioned that last week. You do pick a, like, avatar kind of character,
yeah,
which you can change at any time, which is nice.
Yeah, and it does affect kind of... It does, like, I'd say, like, a story effect. Like, mine was I more prominently get orc cards than any other type of card, And because of that, I most likely am staying with that deck because the cards I'm getting are orc cards. I was like, well, why else am I going to play it?
Right,
so,
right.
Since I'm like role-playing this avatar guy, I'm just going to keep on going with that. But one of the, I'd say, the deck building is good, minus the fact that the pre-made decks, you can only do so much with it. You can only do the two colors that they choose. You can make your own deck of whatever colors you want. That's nice. So that really relieves that pressure.
Right.
The one thing I noticed, and this is probably just because it's in beta, I'm not going to say it's a continuation thing, it seemed like if you lost your very first battle with a story mission, the next battle is so ridiculously easy that you can't lose. Like, I remember going, there was one battle where, like, it was, I probably played, it felt like, I don't know, 20 minutes, so a very long game for this.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I was, we were both down to under 10, and, like, it was coming down to the last turn, and he just got, like, a lucky card and, like, beat me.
Right.
The next match, I didn't lose one health, and I beat him in, like, three turns.
You know, that's really funny you'd say that, because I had a situation like that, too, and I just chalked it up to luck. But maybe you're right. Maybe they do say, whoa, okay, dial back the difficulty.
Maybe, and, like, it could just be luck of the draw, but it seemed like every time I lost once, the next battle was just like, yeah, let's just not even bother playing. Like, yeah. It was just, it
might
was
as well
so
have
weird.
Just won by default.
Yeah, so that was, like, only objection, but
That's interesting if that's an intentional thing, and it's even more interesting if that was just random luck of, like,
yeah, just like
each
how
time
the game,
it
like,
just
interacts.
Was, yeah.
But yeah, it's, but overall, the very first battle through any one of these story missions, I thought was the right level of challenging, plus the level of being unique. But I also do like, basically, at the end of most battles, you have this weird, like, choice between two cards.
Oh, yeah, there's this kind of,
also has a story.
Yeah, there's a sort of morality choice sometimes.
Yeah, like, you can either do something good or something bad, and it gives you these two cards, so either you play it from a role-playing standpoint, or you play it of, I just really like that card.
Yeah, it's not easy, too, because there were some situations where it was like, well, the more immoral choice yielded you a substantially better card.
Yeah, but it's like, but do you want to, like, really say no to this adorable little puppy?
Exactly.
It's like, yeah, so I did like that. I mean, I definitely would say if anyone out there, I would even say if you're an Elder Scrolls fan, the only thing you're really going to get out of this game is that you're going to know some of the races. Besides right. that, I would say anyone who likes Hearthstone or even Magic, I would definitely recommend the beta for. Sign up. It sounds like it's just really easy to get into.
It's actually, it's open now.
Yeah, it's still open, so please go ahead and try it. I would recommend it to probably anybody.
Yeah, if you, it's, I think we said this a little bit last week, it's not necessarily a game for Elder Scrolls fans so much as it's a game for collectible card game CCG fans.
Correct, yeah, and but definitely, it's a really well-done game. I would say even the card animations and stuff like that are really nice.
Yeah.
I really didn't have too many issues. I think I had, like, one minor bug that was, like, on a certain story mission, a certain type of deck always made the game freeze.
Oh, really?
It was weird. Like, it would just, like, it would constantly say, like, it was, like, thinking. Like, that's, and it was only for one deck. Nothing else. I tried other decks, anything else. I tried using that same deck in, like, a practice battle. All worked fine. It was just like that one story mission with that one deck just did not like it. So minor things, but also it's a beta, so it's like it's gonna come with the territory. But
it's a very complete beta.
Yeah, if that's the only thing I find wrong with it, it's a great game.
Yeah, absolutely. What else have you been up to?
I actually have been playing on the PS4. I know, but it is a PC game, so you could just easily pretend I never said that. Just say that this is a PC game.
Even
I'm
though we've
playing,
literally talked about PlayStation 2, Amiga, Dreamcast, MS-DOS, yeah, all these other
all these things. But yeah, I'm actually playing right now. It's a game that's it's the pre-sequel, the Borderlands 3, or Borderlands the pre-sequel.
I love
it's
their actually, sense of humor.
I know. That was probably, it's one of the reasons why Borderlands is such like a favorite series for me, just because they have a certain brand of humor that fits so well into the like, I'd say the Borderlands universe and their storytelling that it just makes you want to play from both the standpoint of they could make you laugh hysterically in one moment and then the next moment just like rip your heart out. So I mean, they're just really great games, and I love Borderlands 1. I love Borderlands 2 probably just as much, if not more. So Borderlands, the pre-sequel, I'd say it's definitely a unique game because it's like the very first time you're looking through the eyes of some of your past enemies, which I thought was really cool.
Hmm.
It's recent enough where I'm going to try to not do too many spoilers.
Sure.
But and another cool thing about it, probably the best thing about it, is that instead of playing on, I guess, the main world that Borderlands 1 and 2 was on, you actually are on the moon this time, which is really cool because it does a bunch of different like game mechanics about it. Like, you can jump a little bit higher, you have like, less weight. You actually have to wear an oxygen pack kind of thing. So it's really cool. And then like, it also basically lets you have different types of enemies, different types of guns, different types of vehicles. So they did their best of going, hey, this is bridging the gap between 2 and 3.
So is this a legitimate like full feature game?
It feels like it. I mean, I don't know if it's the same scale as like Borderlands 2, but it's definitely a full-fledged game. I mean, it has the same amount of characters. It has 6 characters that you can choose from, all have their own, you know, unique skill trees. There's a main story quest with a bunch of side quests. I mean, the graphics are spot on. I mean, so I would say basically it seems like it's a full-fledged game. I think when it was released, I don't think it was released to the scale of like, this is Borderlands 3, but not really. No, right. It was just like it was like, this is a Borderlands game that's going to hold you over till Borderlands 3.
It's the Lion King 1.5 of Borderlands.
Exactly. So, I mean, it's definitely, it feels like as of right now, it's a full-fledged game. It could just be a full-fledged game that's not as long as Borderlands 1 or 2.
Sure.
But, I mean, it's definitely really good. And like I said, I've only played, I wouldn't say a lot of it, but I played the first boss, maybe the first boss or two. I'm having a ton of fun with it. The only thing is, like, the skill trees are definitely very different from the first two. I think it's probably because of the characters you can play.
Mm-hmm.
But they're different in the sense of, like, I feel like in the first two, the characters you play, like, when they all had this, like, max ability that you get when you finally max out one of the three skill trees that just feels, like, super OP.
Right.
Like, and as well it should. But in this one, is like, I feel like each skill tree has its own like quirks and like there's ways of making your character really good, but there wasn't like a game-breaking ability or like, oh, you turned into a Goliath or something. It's
like the one that you're working towards.
Yeah, like it's like that one you really want. So it's like, I mean, but I don't think it's a bad thing. I don't think it's a good thing. It's just, it's different. And I mean, like I said, I'm having a blast with it. I'm really liking my character. And all the characters are flashbacks. Like, you can even play as Jack, who was the, the main enemy in Borderlands 2.
Oh, Handsome Jack, yeah.
Yeah, Handsome Jack. You can play as Claptrap, which I thought was hilarious.
How does Claptrap play?
It's interesting, really. I almost played him, minus the fact that when I was reading up on the class, it's like, this is really a class that really only works if you have just about a full team, because it's like, he's very, one of his trees is very very team focused.
Yeah.
But like his ultimate is funny. It's like his ultimate is that he assesses the situation and randomly uploads a Vault Hunter like behavioral mod.
Oh my god.
And he like takes on that Vault Hunter for like the duration of his ultimate.
Oh
so,
my god, that's funny.
But in true Borderlands and Claptrap fashion, one of his ultimate abilities, like one of his max level skills and one of his skill trees is give me a high five. Like, it literally is he holds up his hand and whatever teammate slaps it, like, both you and them get, like, insane stats for, like, the next however many seconds. But it literally
it's
is, like...
It's Broforce.
Yeah, or, like... but it's just, like, funny. Like, even his skill names are, like, I'm shooting out rainbows and everyone's happy. God. I love this one. Like, it's just, like, they do... You know, that's one thing I love about Borderlands. They go all the way in all ways.
Yeah.
They leave nothing untouched, which is awesome. I love it. I'm definitely looking forward to playing the rest of it. It is definitely a great game. If anyone hasn't played it and you're getting a Borderlands itch because of you don't have 3 yet, I would say definitely check it out.
Is it now, obviously the pre-sequel, is it really third in the sequence? Like, you want to play it third, or is this something that someone could pick up and just play immediately? It sounds like it's referential, so like it really is kind of the third.
It helps if you played the first two. There's references you won't get if you haven't played the first two.
Right.
it would be hard to jump into it and know a lot of it just because it is very referential. It's basically told in a flashback.
Mm-hmm.
But it's definitely after the second one, but it references stuff both from the first one and the second one.
Gotcha.
So I would say it's more so for someone that's played both of them. But you could probably pick it up as a complete noob to Borderlands and still have fun with it.
Cool.
I think you're missing out on like the true background of Borderlands if you don't play at least like the first one and get a sense of like their humor and the world and how everything works.
It's a franchise I've been meaning to get into.
Oh, I definitely think you should. I mean, you know what would be awesome now that I'm thinking about it, and maybe this is an idea that we might not promise on, but it would be great to do a Borderlands Let's Play with the two of us and just have, like, basically just go hog wild with it, because the classes and the characters you can get while you play it would be so fun to do on, a recording, because it's like Broforce when we did those recordings.
Yep.
Like, just so many random things can happen at any given time.
Prone to chaos.
Yeah, exactly, and that's what makes it so much fun. That'd cool. Make it, like, so much fun to watch.
Right on. Well, I know people that, friends of mine and ours that are huge fans of Borderlands, just as a franchise, as a property. So, I definitely, it's on my to play list. I also have, as we talked about last week with Telltale, Tales from the Borderlands, and I still haven't actually played that, but it's there. It's there. It's installed. It's ready to go.
But yeah, no, I definitely say it's a great game. I think it's, anyone who likes Borderlands, go check it out.
Awesome.
And Tom, what's been on your playlist?
I, continuing with our habit of talking about PC games, I've been playing something on Android that originally came out for the PS2 and the 3DS. So this is just, sorry PC fans, we'll be
all
back.
All sorts of over the place.
We'll be back next week in full force, I promise you that. I have been playing Dragon Quest VIII on my phone. Interesting. Very interesting. Still assessing my opinion of it. It was released in 2005. So another first released in Japan in 2004, later released in North America 2005. Its full title was Dragon Quest VIII, The Sky, The Ocean, The Earth, and The Cursed Princess, but it's actually just going by Dragon Quest VIII, Journey of the Cursed King. It's a JRPG through and through. It is, your Final Fantasy kind of game. 3D, very, very appealing visually. Actually, I was really happy because as soon as I fired it up and it had the opening credits, it said character design by Akira Toriyama. I went, oh, because that's, he did Dragon Ball Z. And the characters very much are Dragon Ball looking characters. So that's cool. It's cool to have a game that's that aesthetic, even if it isn't, Dragon Ball Z. It actually, it takes a couple of things from that. They must have consulted him for gameplay, too, because your combat system is your, attack, defend, use item, use spell, flee, kind of, turn-based. And one of the things that you can do is called psych up, which means your character literally just stands in place and goes ah, and increases their aggression towards their next hit. It's like inciting a damage boost exponentially each time you do it. So you can say, okay, I'm gonna psych up for two turns, maybe take a few hits, but I'm gonna one shot this guy pretty much guaranteed by my third turn. I'm not actually a huge JRPG player. I'm a fan. I'm a fan of them. But JRPGs, Japanese RPGs, have a very specific style of gameplay that require a lot of you. They really do. Like, you don't just say, I think I'll just pop into Final Fantasy today. You're playing this and, like, only this. It requires you to be paying attention, to be kind of remembering what's going on, if you have any hope of following the narrative of these things. And I just, I can't be bothered to make that kind of investment
at this point.
I there's a great website, fantastic shout out, howlongtobeat.com. gasp.com. If you're ever curious how long a game will ideally take you, it lists, like, in great detail, you know. If you're just blasting through the game, it'll take you X amount of hours. If you're going through all the collectibles and achievements, it'll take you this amount of hours, stuff like that. And this said, like, at its fastest, it was, like, 80 hours. And I was just like, oh, boy.
Yeah, that reminds me of, like, Star Ocean Forever,
Yep.
And they said, like, the intro, like, literally, like, in Final Fantasy, like, what, the very first opening, what, when you come off the train? What the heck was that mission called? Maybe we need to blow up the reactor. Like, you know, in
seven.
Final Fantasy, yeah, well, it's in 7, but I forget the name of the mission. But yep. it's basically, it would last you, like, what did you think, like, 15, 20 minutes, maybe?
Yeah.
But in Star Ocean thank you forever, the opening equivalent to that was like 40 hours.
Yeah.
To get through the prologue was 40 hours.
This has that feel. I've only played 2.5 hours of it so far. Granted, it very quickly puts you into a town, and I have a big, big, big problem. This is a personal problem that I have, and I acknowledge it, and the first step in resolving a problem is acknowledging the problem. I want to go everywhere and talk to everyone when I go into a town. And so a good, probably, hour was spent talking to every townsperson, and interestingly, it paid off, because a couple of the places you can go, you can go in through, like, the back door, like the employee entrance, and there is one market stand where, this was, like, my first time realizing this, they will acknowledge that you've done that, and so, like, you can go up to the front of a vendor at the marketplace, and he could be like, hey, you want a weapon? I sell weapons, and it just opens up the shop screen. But I went around the back, he was like, oh, are you looking for something special, then? You know, it's like...
That's weird.
And he said, bring me 600 gold pieces and I'll hook you up. So immediately I just, like, said, screw the story mission. I'm going to do everything I can to get whatever this is. This sounds awesome. And it did lead to a thing. I won't spoil it. But it was, like, really interesting. Like, I went in through the back door of another place. Of the inn. And the innkeeper was like, ha, that's the employee's entrance, silly. I was just like, okay. Really weird that he would have the games used to be more creative, I think, in that department, because, you know, you think of, like, Skyrim or whatever, you just, when you're doing the item shop thing, you know, the item shop thing that you do, what you do in RPGs, you just run up to the guy wherever he is, you know, if you happen to go behind the counter, you go behind the counter, whatever. And this actually is like, excuse me, yeah, I work here. Please,
what are you doing?
Please go around the front like everybody else. I was like, oh, sorry. And yeah, all the same, you could still pick up and smash pots and crates and they won't say anything. But it looks like it's really good. It looks like if you're into this kind of thing, it's really good. Combat is really frequent once you leave the town. It does the thing of you run around and there's nothing there, and then all of a sudden it goes, you know, and cuts to a, suddenly you're in combat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think it was like, this was the first, when this came out, this was the first 3D version of this type of game, or at least in the Dragon Quest franchise. It feels really good. It feels really good on mobile. I mean, this is free through the Amazon. It's what they call Amazon Underground. It's a free Amazon app store, Amazon-specific app store. It was a pain in the ass to install because it's 1.5 gigabytes, and, you know, if you have anything on your phone, that's already, like, mostly full. And I couldn't get it to install directly onto the SD card. I had to go through this whole convoluted thing. Unfortunately, I'm probably not going to be playing much of it. But to again, to go back to how it controls on Android, it does this, similar games have done this, where it brings up kind of an emulation of, like, an analog stick. I don't know how else to word it. It's like there's a circle that you
weird
could put
circle area.
Yeah, and you can put your thumb or finger on it. And it actually has some cool flexibility in where exactly on the screen that circle is. So I was really happy about that. So like if you're playing with your right hand and you'd rather have the circle be a little bit more in the lower right, you can do that. Subsequently, if you're switching to your left hand or if you'd prefer to have it in the middle. So that was cool. The buttons felt good. Actually, I was really shocked to find a first-person view kind of mode. You can't keep it up, but if you go into a place and you want to look around, you can actually, if you tap and hold on your character, it just zooms right in to a first-person view. I was like, oh, well, this is neat. So that was kind of cool for immersion, but I don't know. I can already tell what the game's going to offer. It has great reviews through the years, so I'm sure that the story is fun and engaging. The characters seem quirky and fun. I just don't know if I personally have the time for it.
If time wasn't an issue, let's say you've lived in a void and you just could spend forever playing it, would you think it would be a game you'd be excited for, or is it just purely just the length of it is what's daunting?
Well, I mean, that's the thing. It's, again, I'm not a diehard JRPG fan. I think if you are, this is offering it in a great way. If you want to have a Final Fantasy, Star Ocean, you know, whatever type game on your phone, it doesn't feel like it's from 2005. It feels like... One thing that's always frustrated me about mobile games is that there's just design elements for modern mobile games that are like, ugh, you know, a lot of pay-to-win, microtransaction-y stuff.
Unfortunately.
And that's just inherent with the design of modern mobile games. And it's like, why don't they just take old games and re-release them on mobile? Well, this is exactly that, and it works, you know? Why not just release games that, you know, because it's limited hardware, but this runs butter smooth. You know, it's a PS2 game that I looks like it's been optimized, obviously, because, you know, I'm playing it vertically. And, you know,
yeah, something had to happen to
it. It's not like the left and the right sides of the screen are just suddenly missing. It's been adapted for this, and it's all, you know, tap-based and swipe-based stuff. I give it a positive review. Basically, I give it a thumbs up. Unfortunately,
but you won't play it.
Unfortunately, I think I'm going to be uninstalling it. You know,
that's great, but but it's like, I don't know. It goes back. Like, you can identify a good game, just not for you. It's
right,
you know,
exactly.
It does what it wants to do well. It just doesn't do it for me.
Yeah, I think you know, I think it's a really good... I don't have a good point of reference for JRPGs, so I could be really off base.
It's probably the best JRPG you've ever played.
I mean, that's exactly the thing, is I look at the reviews, and it's like the critically acclaimed Dragon Quest VIII, and it's like, cool, I bet it is. I could see where
I bet
this would
cool
be.
Cool at all.
Yeah, I could see where this would be something that people would be like, oh, this is so great. It's not... JRPGs are not my type of game. I have a very specific desire for immersion, and I think, as noobish as it sounds, I think action is a part of that. And so turn-based combat in this way is never something that's gripped me, you know? The Final Fantasy system is just never something that's gripped me. I get why it's awesome, and I get why you know, strategize to hell and back with it. But I just like a little bit more of a presence. I've talked about this on previous episodes. I like a little bit more of an agency directly.
Yeah, kind of like, you know, like a dot hack or one of the newer Final Fantasies.
Yeah.
Or...
yeah. I mean, I'm looking at Final Fantasy, what is it, 15?
Final Fantasy. Yeah. Final Fantasy Infinite.
The last Final Fantasy again.
Again, yeah.
But I'm looking at that because it just looks like, hey, this could be fun to play, you know? So, I mean, who knows? But yeah, Dragon Quest VIII, if you've got a gigabyte and a half free on your phone and you don't know what to do with it, this'll fill it up real fast.
And with that, I think that's probably a good way of summing it up.
Yep. The only other thing really that I played this week was Sleeping Dogs, but that's because I never uninstall Sleeping Dogs.
It's just a game you always go back into.
Sleeping Dogs is one of those games that just, it's like, if I get a new computer, it's going to be one of the first games I install. I think that is one of the most underrated games ever. Like, if we ever do a top five underrated games, that's like two for me.
I couldn't agree with you more. It was, I remember, I only knew about this game because you turned me on to it. You're like, you know what, you should probably try Sleeping Dogs. I'm like, maybe. I think I got it on a sale or something. And as soon as I started playing, I think before, like, as soon as I installed it and hit the start button, I feel like I hit you up on Facebook like, oh my God.
Yeah, yeah. It's, I need to specify this because, especially, I know Alec, our friend Alec, gets this mixed up all the time. Sleeping Dogs is not Watch Dogs.
Correct.
These are two very different games.
If you say they are, if you, it's a crime to say they're related.
Ha! Huh, speaking of crime, yes, Sleeping Dogs is a, it was originally a true crime game, I guess, and it became its own independent thing. It's a Hong Kong Grand Theft Auto. Grand Theft Auto Hong Kong.
It's basically, but the triads, it's basically yep. You're the, you know, Hong Kong version of a gangster.
Yeah, and if you're into that kind of like that kind of cinema, or even just the flavor of it, heck, if you're into Bruce Lee and Enter the Dragon, there's references aplenty with this. Actually, the very beginning of that film has, you know, this great sweep of Hong Kong, and oh my God, you start this game, and especially when you're in like the Aberdeen area of the game, you're there. It's just like, oh my God, this is it. This is literally it. But there's also a DLC that directly references the Bruce Lee film, so that's really cool. But it's a I say it's like Grand Theft Auto, but narratively it couldn't be less like Grand Theft
Auto.
Yeah,
it's like I think the only similarity it really has is that the play style is similar. I mean, yep. Like it's open world, you're kind of a crime lord, but yeah, the narrative and the story, which really what makes a game shine, nothing alike.
Yeah, the premise is that you're an undercover cop infiltrating the triads. But you're also very, you quickly sympathize with the triads, the triad gangs, you know, and
yeah, and you start to go down the emotional pathway of, you know, are you siding with your cop side, or are you actually starting to convert over to the other side? Are you in too deep?
And it's just really good. You really start to feel like, oh my God, no, I really care about these gangsters, this triad, specific, what is it? Is it the Red Lanterns? I might have that wrong, but there's
I know what you're talking about. Yeah,
the specific sub gang that you are, you start to really care about these characters. There's some really good character and writing in it, and the cutscenes, you know, are very cinematic. Your character that you play as, Wei, is a really cool guy. I like him a lot. I enjoy playing as him a lot. He's really likable. He's really sympathetic. And it does a good job of bridging the, are you a cop or are you a gangster? You know, and it resolves in an interesting way. It's maybe a little predictable, maybe a little bit not. But the whole journey along the way, you're in this gorgeously realized version of Hong Kong. Like, what a taste of virtual tourism this game is. Like, even so far as when I've played it for a long time, because you're in Hong Kong, you're driving on the left side of the road, I start to get confused in real life when I get back into a car.
Remind me I'm not like, to go up there anytime too soon.
Yeah, I know. I'm like, oh, that's right. We're on the right side here. But it's funny because it feels like it plays into a couple of cliches. It feels like where GTA is lampooning society, you know, it's, you know, your soda is sprunk and you've got stuff that's just all penis and butt jokes all over the place, and people are generally jerks, and it's kind of like South Park in that it's holding up a really big ugly mirror to society and being like, hey, what does this remind you of? This is much more endearing. It's a very kind of like cinematic but still honest feel of Hong Kong, you know, of the nightlife. Oh, when it rains in that game,
it is gorgeous.
And you're driving down these neon soaked, you know, sign rain soaked streets in a nice car. It brings back memories of Midnight Club, you know. It feels cool. There's not a lot to do in the game as far as side stuff. There's fun scripted side missions, and there are races, but you're gonna win the race each time. You know, there's no measure of difficulty to it. You're really in it to carry this narrative along, which, thank God, because the narrative's excellent. It's really excellent. It's really good. It's a really good story.
I could not say enough positive things about this game.
Yep. Well, I suppose that wraps it up.
Yeah, I think that's another, you know, that's going to hit another end on episode 4 of the Addicted to Loot podcast. And before we get into our big farewells, I would like to throw in a little teaser cliffhanger. Next week, big episode, really huge game. You could probably guess it by our previous episodes.
Yeah, $5 to the person who guesses what next week's episode is going to be probably entirely about.
Maybe even featuring a special guest. You don't say.
Who's it going to be? We'll find out if it's going to be anybody. But we have
rumor on Twitter is it's Robert Downey Jr.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So, you know, tune in, because that's going to probably be who it is.
Most likely than not, I mean.
But yeah, no, fingers crossed. We're setting some neat stuff up for next week. It should shape up to be a pretty fun episode. We're going to be talking about No Man's Sky. Because that's out today, as of our recording here on Tuesday. It's out for PS4. On Friday, it's going to be out for PC, which I get the feeling that you and I are both going to be picking that up.
Yes.
Pretty much immediately. It's very funny, just not to get too deep into it, but our impressions of the news coverage and previews and videos of this week have left us feeling cautiously positive.
Yeah, I'd say even verging on optimistically positive.
Optimistically positive. I think that I was talking with you about this, and I was talking also with Chris Paquette. Shout out to Chris, another rad dude and erstwhile video game chat companion, about this the stream that Hello Games did yesterday. They did a like hour-ish long stream of just straight gameplay, and for once it was really raw and a bit rough. For once it was like he wasn't doing well. He was in some situations where he was dying and screwing up and kind
definitely
of like,
non-scripted.
Yeah, it was astoundingly non-scripted, and that alone did more to convince me that of what the game will provide than anything else has in the past 3 years. Like, I to see like this kind of back against the wall survival that situations that he was forced into. My only downsides is the ship combat looks really limp.
Yeah, that's to me as well. I mean, even your first person combat on planet is kind of limp. And there's a few things like the starports look a little lackluster. There's
Samey.
Like one major room that you really care about, and even like the random huts you encounter, or like I'd say planetary encampments that you encounter, are very similar. Like it's the same type of circular room and all that other stuff, but it sounds like they're planning on patching it out and doing it an update. So I'm cautiously optimistic the fact that it will sprout into more than what it currently is, but those are like the minor like objections I would have with it.
I it's funny because my ambition has changed. I said to you last week or maybe over the weekend that I like the concept of, because they were talking about that they're going to be adding large freighter ships to the game post-launch. I thought, oh, great, I could be like the East India Trading Company in space, you know, and have yeah. like a corner of the galaxy that I've just got the market on and have fun, you know, running trading routes. But as I was watching the stream and reading subsequent, you know, early reviews for the PS4 copies, I think I might actually just want to be a wildlife photographer. Like,
yeah, and I think realistically the game is more geared towards that. But
like, I have no problem essentially role-playing the concept of a No Man's Sky Ford prefect, you know, going around writing my own version of the Hitchhiker's Guide to No Man's Sky and taking pictures of the different things that I find. And I'm sure I'll be coding my social media, Twitter, Tumblr, Facebook, with screenshots of this game. I did that in GTA 5. I really loved the fact that they had an Instagram element in GTA 5, and I had fun treating that like I do in real life, going, you know, on hikes up Mount Chiliad and being like, look at this neat tree, look at this rabbit, look at this, wow, and taking the pictures and posting them like I would in real life.
No, definitely, and I think, you know, this is all just a big teaser till next week, our big feature episode, so please tune in next Friday at that time to take in our big No Man's Sky episode, which would probably be including all of our actual in-game experiences as well. But until then, you can follow us on our website, which is addictedtoloot.weebly.com. Reach out to us on email, which is addictedtoloot@gmail.com. Once again, you can always look at us at our Addicted to Loot with the number 2 Twitter account, our personal account, which myself is
numeral
at
two.
Fifth, FITH_addicted_atomic0. And then you have at Tomality with Tom. Also look at our Addicted to Loot Facebook, our YouTube, as well as our Twitch, which we don't really use as much as we should, but it's also there.
Well, you know, who knows? We may be using the Twitch for No Man's Sky.
No, definitely. I think it's definitely a possibility, as well as you can also subscribe to us on our brand new servers of iTunes and Stitcher, SoundCloud, and YouTube. So please go and check that all out. But until then, I have been Brian.
I have been very thirsty and gone through a lot of water during this episode.
Amen to that, brother. Atomic and Addicted to Loot out.